Good afternoon. On behalf of the Cedars, it is my privilege to welcome you here this afternoon. And as this program called First Fridays first began, some of the faculty on campus used to ask me, well, what's it like to talk to folks at the Cedars? I said, well, it's a very bright group, well-educated, and there are two differences with a traditional classroom. Number one, if persons can't hear you, they're going to let you know. And number two, they're going to clamor for the seats up in front. We're in for a treat with Joe Dickhudt today, and it's great to see students and faculty from McPherson College, as well as us persons from the Cedars community. I had a former student a number of years ago by the name of James Keith. James was one of the outstanding music majors, but he also had a double major in auto restoration. And I remember him telling me one time, he said, Joe Dickhudt is one of my very favorite teachers on campus. What that man knows is absolutely incredible. So you're in for a treat. And it's my privilege to introduce to you Monica Rice, who will be introducing Professor Dickhudt.
Thank you very much, Steve, and thank you all for being here. It looks like we're going to have to rethink how much coffee and cookies we have out because these are becoming more and more popular, so that's great news. And special welcome to the AR students and staff that came. I heard that Professor Dickhudt has quite a following of groupies on campus, so I'm glad to see some of you here. And so in just a moment, after I make a few announcements, we will get to enjoy this presentation from Professor Dickhudt, which is entitled The Apollo Space Program in Perspective, Looking Back 50 Years. And it is a special opportunity because Professor Dickhudt actually worked on the Apollo program. So that is really exciting. And I want to draw your attention that there is a display of Apollo badges at the back of the room that he has brought. So if you didn't look at those on the way in. They are really neat to see the history of the program and the badges. So that's all that I have, and I'm very anxious to welcome and hear from Professor Dickhudt.
Thank you for letting me join you today. As Monica said, I had the good fortune, the privilege, and the honor, really, of being a small part of the Apollo program. And to put that program in perspective, I'd like to take you back some 60 years, October 4th, 1957, the dawn of the space age. On that date, Russia launched Sputnik 1, the very first satellite to orbit the Earth. It was 184 pounds, 22 inches in diameter, and it included a radio beeper on it. And that radio beeper essentially broadcast across the world and around the world an intercontinental outer space raspberry to the United States. The reaction to Sputnik was amazement and wonder all across the world. Headlines and headpapers and newspapers, the space age is here, Russia wins the race, satellite heard by millions. And indeed, it was one of the largest, maybe the largest shock of the last century. Everybody knew that mankind was on the verge of going into space. And everybody just assumed, however, that it was going to be American mankind. The American public was stunned, literally stunned, when the Russians made this. People all over the world, all over the country, strained to see the satellite. Indeed, the Russians had polished it so that the sun would reflect off of it in the morning hours and the evening hours. Newspapers ran articles telling you where you could see it, where you could look, and millions of people strained to see it, and a lot of people did see it. Not only could you see it, you could hear it. It broadcast a steady tone. It broadcast on 20 megacycles and 40 megacycles. 20 megacycles in particular was a very easy frequency for people around the world to pick up on general radio. And there you can get a picture of what it looked like. But let me share with you, so many people heard Sputnik, and I'd like you to hear what it sounded like. This was the voice of Sputnik. What it was saying to the world is, I'm here. 1 week later, the Soviets launched the first hydrogen bomb, exploded the first hydrogen bomb, their first. This was 1,000 times the power of the atomic bomb that the United States dropped in Japan. The implications of this were obvious. The Russians were in space. They had the hydrogen bomb. In fact, Nikita Khrushchev, premier of the Soviet Union at the time, liked to say that, as of now, America sleeps under a Soviet moon, and that Soviet moon carries the punch of a hydrogen bomb. 2 weeks later, they launched Sputnik 2, launched an animal into space, a dog. Her name was Laika, which is Russian for lady. 1,000-pound satellite. Oh, if anybody wasn't sure that Sputnik was able to carry through on the threat of a nuclear weapon, launching a 1,000-pound satellite made it pretty clear. America responded in the only logical way you could see at the time and started building bomb shelters. It was a deadly serious. People from the time remember that bomb shelters in your backyard, stocked and provided, was considered the prudent and logical thing to do. There were all sorts of publications at the time, how to survive the atomic fallout, how to survive atomic bombs. And it was deadly serious. Serious to the point sometimes of being ridiculous. For school children at the time, they had what were called duck and cover exercises. Some of you remember that, the height of hypocrisy, really. When the big one comes, get to a safe place under a wooden desk. When you see the big one, duck and cover. And here's the thing. It wasn't if you see the big one, it was when you see the big one. It was expected. 2/3 of the American public in the 1950s believed that nuclear war was imminent. And 90% of those believed that it would be catastrophic. And no doubt it certainly would have been. America tried to respond to the Russian Sputnik. Our answer to the Soviet threat was the Vanguard rocket and the Vanguard satellite. Vanguard 1. Weighed 3 pounds, it was 6 inches in diameter. Khrushchev called it the flying grapefruit. It had a hard time actually getting to be flying. December 6, 1957, the United States tried to launch Vanguard 1. It was more popularly after that called Flopnik because it blew up on the launch pad. The second attempt in February of 1958 was more aptly called Kaputnik. It also exploded on the pad, tremendous explosion. At this point, the Russians are putting 1,000-pound satellites into orbit. The United States is unable to put a 3-pound satellite into orbit. Finally, in March of 1958, the Grapefruit satellite is launched, again, 3 pounds, 6 inches in diameter. The Russians respond by launching Sputnik 3, May of 1958, a 3,000-pound satellite, the size of a large full car, 1,000 times the size of the American satellite in orbit. January of 59, the Russians launch a satellite in orbit around the moon, a tremendous accomplishment. Luna 1, popularly called Lunik, sent pictures back of the backside of the moon, had never before been seen by mankind. And April of 1961, the Russians put the first man in space, Major Yuri Gagarin. His response to being in orbit, his first words back on being in orbit were, "I can see the Earth below. It's absolutely beautiful." Man enters space. The shock again around the world. Man enters space, and it's a Russian man, a Russian major. This is the Huntsville Times at the time, and an article down in the corner says that Wernher von Braun says, "If the United States is to keep up, we have to run like hell." In fact, President Kennedy raised the stakes May 25th, 1961, saying, "I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth." Quite a goal. The race for the moon was on in full swing. Finally, in May of 1961, the United States gets an astronaut into space. The first American in space was Alan Shepard, May 5th, 1961. He didn't go into orbit. He was 15 minutes in a suborbital flight. But we had a man in space. The second man in space, Liberty Bell 7, July 21st, 1961. Piloted by Gus Grissom. And this turned out to be a remarkable and noteworthy flight for a couple of reasons. One of which is that when the spacecraft landed, it sat in the water for just a few minutes, and the capsules had an explosive hatch, so they could blow the hatch off to get out if they needed to get out in a hurry. And as Gus was waiting to be picked up by helicopter, the hatch blew off of the spacecraft, and water started pouring in. He managed to get out of the spacecraft in a spacesuit still as the water was pouring in. The helicopters that came to recover latched onto the capsule, which was sinking, and tried to recover that satellite, the capsule. But it was, by that point, filling with water. In this particular picture, you can see the helicopter trying to pull the capsule out of the water, and you can see the water pouring out of the spacecraft. And what happened is the spacecraft, as it more and more water filled into it, it became heavier and heavier, and the helicopter that was trying to pick it up just kept sinking down lower and lower because they couldn't do it. Meanwhile, Gus Grissom was off to the side, waving his hands in the water. And the helicopter crew thought, well, that's Gus telling us that he's okay, so we can concentrate on getting the capsule. What Gus was trying to say is, hey, I'm over here and I'm drowning. Water was filling up with his spacesuit. He was starting to sink, trying to stay abreast. They finally gave up on trying to recover the satellite. They couldn't. And finally turned their attention to Gus, who by this point was practically drowned. Everybody thought at the time that Gus must have done something. The only explanation for why that hatch could be blown was that somehow Gus must have blown it. He maintained that he didn't, maintained that he was innocent. Most people figured, well, yeah, probably. Probably he may not have realized he did it, but how else could it have happened? As a result of the hatch blowing on the spacecraft, they eliminated the explosive hatch on future spacecraft, so there was no chance that it would blow accidentally. The spacecraft itself was lost in 16,000 feet of water, and it was recovered July 20th, 1999, after almost 40 years. And it was restored and put on display at the Kansas Cosmosphere, right here in Hutch. A national treasure, an unbelievable Kansas national treasure right here, the Cosmosphere. And if you get a chance to visit the Cosmosphere, you can see Liberty Bell 7 on display. And one of the things they found when they finally recovered the satellite was that the switch that said blow the hatch had not been tripped. And it turns out 40 years later, finally, we know Gus was innocent. Back at the ranch, back in 1962. Finally, February 1962, we put the first American in orbit, John Glenn on Friendship 7. Orbits the Earth three times. Becomes a truly national hero. Maybe one of the last really, truly national heroes in this country. Here's a shot of the ticker tape parade, which welcomed him in New York City in March of 1962. The fact that the United States finally had somebody in orbit was just a huge, huge accomplishment after all of what had been through. The Russians, in 1963, put the first woman in space, Valentina Tereshkova. And I really like that painting. I think that's a beautiful painting. And in 1965, the Russians had the first spacewalker. By spacewalker, we mean somebody who leaves the capsule and is free in space, of course. When you look back at this, you find out that, politics aside, the people that did this, the people in these space programs for both the United States and Russia, were just extraordinary people. And Alexei is an example. It turned out when he did his spacewalk and he got outside the capsule, not too surprisingly perhaps, his spacesuit expanded like a balloon in a vacuum. And he couldn't get back into the capsule. He couldn't fit back inside the door. What he did to try and get back inside the capsule was start letting the air out of his spacesuit. Here he is, 100-some miles above the Earth, can't get in the spacecraft. He's letting the air out of his spacesuit. I have to tell you, if this had been me, there'd be something else in that space point at this side. He said later that he didn't report this at the time by radio because if you're at flight control in Moscow, couldn't do anything to help him, so there was no sense in telling him. He finally did get back in, and he finally had a successful landing. Then, April of 1965, the American public is stunned once again. There's an article coming out of Russian papers, and it's called The Flight of Nikevo 1. And the story from Russia says that the Russians have landed a spacecraft on Venus with colonists. They're going to set up permanent colonies on Venus. So they had a 20,000 pounds spacecraft with 16 passengers. And the Russians had accomplished so much by this point that it was just like, oh my goodness, you know, how much more can they do? This is just incredible beyond words. Finally, some folks who understood and spoke Russian looked at this and said that, well, interestingly enough, Nikovo means in Russian, no big deal. And the commander of the mission, Valesi Aprildurka, when you translate that, it means April Fool. So not only were the Russians accomplishing some tremendously major things, they were having some fun at the expense of the United States and the rest of the world, too. Meanwhile, we go back again. 1965, the Gemini program starts, the first step towards accomplishing the president's goal. Gemini 4, 1965, is the first American spacewalk. And there's something else that happens in the summer of 1965, which is really dramatic. And that is our hero enters the space program. Forgive me for having a little fun with you, too. I share this with you because, as a young man, it is such a heavy burden, some of you may recall, to be cool. The requisite cigarette and the shades. But I had the honor and the good fortune, the privilege to work on the Apollo program. I went to work for NASA at North American Aviation in Downey, California. North American Aviation, a long-standing tremendously successful company. They built the P-51 aircraft fighter during World War II. They built the MiG F-86 Sabre jet during the Korean War. A long history of wonderful undertakings. And they won the contract with NASA to build the command and service modules for the Apollo. This is the service module, and this is the command module. The command module, of course, is where the astronauts were, and the service module maintained all of the infrastructure needed for life support. They were both built as a team called the CSM, Command and Service Module, by North American Aviation in Downey. My job, working with NASA and working with Downey, was involved in spacecraft test and acceptance, spacecraft checkout and acceptance. And what we did was use computers to put the spacecraft as it was being built through various tests. And as it passed, each series of tests would go on and continue being built, and more of it built and more of it being tested. We ran the simulated missions through computers. As a lead engineer, I worked in the computer room. Adjacent to that, we had a control room, which was a mock-up of what they would have in Houston for an actual launch. And as well as doing training, test and checkout on the spacecraft, we did simulated missions for the astronauts, and we did training for the people that were ultimately going to be controllers. Well, we're doing a lot trying to put these spacecraft together. The technology that we had, if you look back to 1965, is just so primitive compared to what we're used to today. The Apollo mainframe that we used had a memory, this is staggering, of 8,000 bytes, 8 KB. That would be enough nowadays to hold a little more than one page of typewritten text. We had 100,000 transistors. We could manage to run an amazing 50,000 instructions per second on those little computers, and they weren't that little, they filled up a room. And the computers cost $3 million a piece. Compare that with an Apple iPhone, typically a memory of 64 gigabytes in an iPhone, 4 billion transistors, 2 billion instructions per second, and if you get it with a contract, it costs $200. Yeah. When I first started working with Downey, we were building what are called boilerplates. And these were mock-ups of the Apollo intended for various tests. a lot of conceptual training, a lot of is this going to be right? One of the first tests and mock-ups that we did, you know, when you think back on this, it seems, gosh, what could be more obvious? But one of the first things we had to do was find out, will the command module float? Ideally, we're going to go around the moon, come back. It'd be nice when we land in the ocean and we're waiting for recovery if it'll float. What we found out is that it'll float just fine. And sometimes it floats right side up and sometimes it floats right side down. We found this out. North American built a huge, huge pool, put it in one of the large parking lots, and filled it up with water. Brought the boilerplates out, they'd have a crane pick up the boilerplate, swing it over the tank of water and drop it, and see how it survived the drop and see how it survived the floating. As I said, we found out that half the time it would float right side up, half time not. A lot of the solutions that we came up with looked kind of simple, but they worked. The solution to having the spacecraft float right side up was, if it's upside down, put a balloon on it, fill that with air and it'll pop it over. Oh, when you see pictures of these modules after recovery, that's what the balloons are for on top, is to pop it back over if it floats upside down. We also found out on one of the boilerplate tests, the crane operator picked up the Apollo, the boilerplate, And instead of swinging it over the tank, he accidentally swung it the other way over the parking lot and dropped it. But we dropped it from a couple hundred feet onto a solid ground and found out that landing on solid ground is not a good idea for the spacecraft. The first real vehicle that we worked on, the first real vehicle that I had the honor to work on, was Apollo 1. Grissom, White, and Chafee. Here are some pictures of Apollo 1 being built and tested in Downey, California. The amazing thing about Apollo 1, as we tested it, was that it failed every single test. Everything it was supposed to do, it did wrong or it did not at all. It was just terrible. Everybody knew at the time that that the astronauts had the final decision on whether or not to accept any vehicle. And I was sure that when push came to shove, the astronauts would not accept this vehicle. One of the fellows that I worked with said that he wouldn't ride in the Apollo 1 vehicle if they put it on the back of a truck to take it across the street. What I didn't realize, of course, is that the guys that are flying this, the astronauts, it's just not in their DNA to turn down a mission. They just don't do that. But they weren't pleased with the spacecraft. In fact, this is the crew praying to a higher authority, please make this work. In fact, there was a poster that Gus put up at North American. This is Gus Grissom, and it says, all I ask is do good work. Do the best you can. In January of 1967, we sent the Apollo 1 to the Cape for continued testing for eventual launch. On January 22nd, 1967, Gus Grissom was so unhappy with this vehicle that he hung a lemon over the front door. And we know what the lemon means, right? That was January 22nd. January 27th, 5 days later, the fire broke out. While the vehicle was in test, fire broke out, killed all three astronauts, Grissom, White, and Chafee. What had happened? They were doing what's called a plugs-out test, which means that the aircraft, the spacecraft, is supposed to run on its own internal power, being autonomous. For the purposes of the test, they pressurized the vehicle with pure oxygen. There was some temporary wiring that somehow had been installed in the spacecraft, and that temporary wiring was not shielded. And the insulation on those wires was rubbed off, finally to the point where they had a short circuit and created a spark. A spark in a pure oxygen environment caused an immediate, intense fire. The sad irony of this is, it was Gus Grissom who was the commander of this crew, the same Gus Grissom who had had the problem with Liberty Bell 7. They were unable to get out of the spacecraft when the fire started, because there was no explosive hatch, and they didn't have enough time to release the hatch and get out. The terrible irony is, it was because of Gus Grissom's first flight that they didn't have the explosive hatch, and the loss of the explosive hatch ultimately is what led to the death of the crew. I should say led to the inability of the crew to escape. The fault for the shoddy construction was not their fault. What happened? Everything on the program to this point had been rush, rush, rush. We've got to beat the Russians. We've got to get there first. You know, sure, safety is important, but we got to get there first. After the fire, the attitude was slow down, take a step back, think about what we're doing. If it takes a little longer to get there, let's get there for real instead of not. everything came to a stop, and we started over again. The next vehicle that I worked on was called Block 2 test vehicle. It was 2TV1. Block 1 Apollo vehicles were Apollo vehicles that were in Earth orbit. Block 2 vehicles were those that were intended to go to the moon and back. The Block 2, 2TV1, was basically a boilerplate of the whole Apollo. It wasn't intended to fly. It was intended to be a test of how to do it right, how to build it right, how to get the infrastructure right. We went through a long period of tests on 2TV1, and the difference was night and day. It did everything it was supposed to. It passed every test with flying colors. It was the way it should have been. That led to Apollo 7, called the Phoenix, launched in October of 1968, a flawless vehicle, the way it should have been. Passed every test and passed the mission. That led to Apollo 8, December 1968. Apollo 8's the first vehicle that went to the moon, went around the moon and back. But Apollo 8 wasn't supposed to go to the moon. That's not its intention. That's not what it was built for. The United States government got intelligence on the Russian program in November of 68, well, fall of 68, that the Russians were ready to launch a vehicle to the moon. And the feeling was, gee, we've got to do something about that. Even though we had just stopped for a year to say, let's do this right, let's not rush into it, let's think about what we're doing, the decision was made, let's scrap the plan that we have for Apollo 8 and go to the moon. And it worked. A litany of firsts on Apollo 8. This was the very first manned flight of the Saturn V, the heavy lift vehicle. The first time from space that human eyes look back and see the Earth. The good planet Earth on Christmas Eve 1968, many of you remember this. God created the heavens and the earth. We see the backside of the moon with human eyes for the first time on Apollo 8. On Apollo 10, we have a dress rehearsal for the landing on the moon. On Apollo 10, we send the command module, service module, and a lunar module. The lunar module flies to within a couple miles of the moon's surface. NASA was concerned a little bit that when you got these guys that close to the moon, they might just want to go ahead and land and do it, even though that wasn't the mission. So what NASA did on Apollo 10 was put no fuel in the lunar module for liftoff. So if they landed, they were there forever, and that was done to make sure that they didn't. It was a successful flight. And then, of course, Apollo 11, the Eagle has landed. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind, and amazing. But it almost didn't happen. It turns out that on landing the lunar module was being piloted by onboard computer. And halfway through the descent program, the computer decided that it couldn't handle the landing anymore and did what computers are so notorious for and said, I quit. Houston wanted to abort the mission at that point. And Neil Armstrong said he'd rather not. He said he could fly the vehicle himself manually to landing. And they gave him a go-ahead to do that. And it's probably a good thing because as it came down to the point, the place where they had intended to land, they found that it was strewn with rocky boulders. There was no flat place to land. And Neil Armstrong ended up flying the lunar lander, flying it over the surface of the moon, looking for a place to land. If you ever have a chance to listen to the tapes that they made at the time, while Neil Armstrong is looking for a place to land, you hear somebody in the background saying, 60 seconds. And what that 60-second comment meant was that at that point, he had 60 seconds of fuel left. And he has no reaction to it. He just keeps on flying. Finally finds a place that he likes and sets down, of course. And he had, when he landed, 15 seconds of fuel left. In one of the news briefings after he came back, nobody at the time knew that he had that little left, but at a conference, news conference when he was back, one of the reporters asked him if he wasn't a little bit nervous about the time that he was running out of fuel. And his response to them was, well, anybody who's ever driven a car knows that when the fuel gauge says empty, you've always got a gallon left. A billion people watched July 20th, 1969. And then they did the lunar rendezvous. The lunar module took off and met up with the command module, service module. What most people didn't know at the time was that when they got back into the lunar module to take off and come back up for ascent, the switch that ignited the module for takeoff was broken off. Probably somebody in the process of dressing up in the space chute must have hit it and broken it. So they're ready to take off, and there's no switch. And Buzz Aldrin managed to solve that problem. They had ballpoint pens with them, and he managed to jimmy a ballpoint pen and use that to trip the switch to ignite the engine for launch. What we left behind, we came in peace. Here men from the planet Earth first set foot upon the moon, July 1969. Tranquility. If you ever look at the moon and you wonder where tranquility is, this is the face of a full moon. And right about here is where the first landing was. Apollo 12 was an incredibly precise mission. They managed on Apollo 12 to land within walking distance of the Surveyor 3 satellite, which had been put up to the moon 2 years earlier. In fact, we now have an orbit around the moon, a satellite called the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, LRO for short, which has taken detailed pictures of the moon. And this picture came back in September 2011. It's a picture of the Apollo 12 landing site from the Lunar Observer Reconnaissance Orbiter. And you can see the Intrepid, the descent stage. You can see the Surveyor 3 spacecraft. And you can even see the astronauts' footprints as they walked from the Apollo vehicle to the Surveyor 3 spacecraft and back. Then Apollo 13. Houston, we've got a problem, serious problem, and we all know, I hope you've all seen the movie, it's an excellent movie. But the movie doesn't tell you, however, what really happened. And what happened is that in Apollo, April 1970, Apollo 13 was lunar bound. Apollo 13, like all the Apollo spacecraft, had three fuel cells for electrical energy. They were in the service module. They were powered by two sets of liquid hydrogen and oxygen tanks. And the idea of a fuel cell is that we combine hydrogen and oxygen to produce water and electricity. On the evening of April 13th, the pressure on the fuel cell was a little low, and Houston asked the astronauts to do one more thing, and that is stir up the tanks and increase the pressure a little bit in the fuel cell. This is a picture of what the service module looks like. And tucked down in the corner of the service module are the fuel cells. Pressurized oxygen and hydrogen creating electricity. Well, astronaut Jack Swigert complied with Houston's request and he stirred the tanks. There was a muffled explosion and battery voltage started dropping immediately. It took almost 10 minutes to realize the magnitude of the problem, however, and that was that oxygen 2 tank had blown up, Oxygen tank number one was damaged by the explosion and venting oxygen into air. Without oxygen, all three fuel cells were quickly losing power. Well, why did this happen? The oxygen tanks were built with electric heaters inside them, and these heaters could be turned on to increase the pressure of the oxygen so that the fuel cell would operate more efficiently. The early Apollo vehicles used 28-volt systems and 28-volt heaters, Apollo 1, for example. The later vehicles, the Block 2 vehicles, used 65-volt heaters. Oxygen tank number 2 in Apollo 13 had originally been installed on Apollo 10 and then removed and reinstalled on Apollo 13. Apollo 13 was built for use with 65-volt heaters. Tank number 2 was equipped with a 28-volt heater. What happened is running this heater at the higher voltage, the heater finally shorted out. And when it shorted out, it sparked. And once again, what we had was a spark in a pure oxygen environment. Houston, we've got a problem. This is a painting, by the way, done by Apollo 12 astronaut, Alan Bean. It's been called NASA's finest hour. Gene Kranz called it that, flight director. I knew enough about the program at the time and about the spacecraft to know that, if you'll excuse me, that there wasn't a snowball's chance in hell that they were going to come home. It just couldn't happen. It was impossible. And NASA did the impossible. NASA did the impossible. The crew of Apollo 13 did the impossible. They landed the spaceship manually. And what's amazing is, even if they came back to the Earth, which I thought was never going to happen, if they had managed to land within 1,000 miles of the recovery ship, I would have thought that's awesome. They managed to land so close to the recovery ship, the Iwo Jima, that they were able to take pictures from the boat of the spacecraft flashing down. Apollo 15, 16, and 17 were all about lunar exploration. In fact, what's great about these is not only did we get the astronauts to the moon, but we gave them a go-kart to drive around the moon. Pretty amazing. Apollo 17 was the last mission, December 1972. There were supposed to be 3 more missions. But they were canceled. They were canceled because of the war in Vietnam. The government decided that the money was more useful buying bombs to drop on Vietnam than it was building spacecraft to go to the moon. One of many unfortunate things about the war in Vietnam. Apollo 17, after 40 years, thanks to the LRO, we can still see the footprints and the vehicle tracks and the vehicle itself left over after all these years. The legacy of Apollo started really for the wrong reasons. It was started as part of the Cold War to intimidate the Russians and terminated for all the wrong reasons because of another war. Nonetheless, Kennedy's commitment captured the American imagination and indeed the imagination of the world in a way that maybe hasn't happened since. At the end of the day, Apollo stands as a testimony to man's vision and courage. Apollo's promise was to bring the world together. We came in peace for all mankind. And for all mankind, that means not just American mankind, of course. I take you back to Major Yuri Gagarin, Russian, and what he said. "Circling the Earth in my orbital spaceship, I marveled at the beauty of our planet. People of the world, let us safeguard and enhance this beauty and not destroy it." The real legacy of Apollo. Thank you all very much.
Professor Dickhudt has offered that if there are any questions, he's happy to take those. And so we have about 10 minutes, I think. So are there any questions that anyone would like to ask after this fabulous presentation?
How did the lander attach to the actual capsule?
On launch, the lander would be behind the service module. Once they were in orbit, what they would do is unpack the lander and then move it around to the front. And from that point on, it would be attached to the nose of the command module, and they could go with a little tunnel between the two spacecraft. When they detached to land on the moon, they would close that little tunnel, go down. When they came back up, it was the same thing. They would launch or attach at the nose.
Joe, I recently just heard in the news that with Obama having canceled all the moon flights and us going to the moon and wanting to go to Mars instead, I have heard that is possibly going to be reversed and that the present administration is more interested in going back to the moon.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that is a more viable thing for us to do than to achieve something so far-fetched? But since we are so far-fetched of going to Mars, which do you think would be more advantageous money-wise for us to spend our money on?
I think when the astronauts left the moon, Gene Cernan was the last man on the moon. And he just died recently. His comment at the time was, we leave the moon as we came and as we hope people will return in peace. I don't think anybody at that time could have imagined that 50 years later we would not have been back to the moon. My own personal feeling is we need to go back to the moon. There's more to learn there. But probably more important, the ability to get to the moon is the ability we need to do everything else that we need to do, in my opinion. So I hope we do it. I never understood why Obama didn't. But yes, sir.
How in the world did you end up at McPherson College with the background and experience you have?
I had the good fortune after the Apollo program to continue working with space programs and flight programs. In the mid-60s, Apollo was the leading force in developing computer systems, and I had the good fortune to work with Apollo computer systems. And I had the good fortune after that program ended to go on, and I spent most of my career working with the Navy, with the Air Force, doing flight tests for jet aircraft, using a lot of the same technology that we used. Interestingly enough, during all of the years that I worked with space programs and flight programs, my way of escaping from the tension and the pressure of work was to come home and work on my old car. And you guys can appreciate what that's like. At one point, I finally decided, I've got to get into this for real. And there's only one place to get into it for real, and that's right here in McPherson. So, welcome you guys.
Could you speak just a minute about the space station? I know that's not Apollo, but
it all comes together. They've done some amazing things on the space station, and the shuttle did some really amazing things. The downside of both of those, however, is that they're low orbit. They're close to Earth, and what we need to redevelop is an ability to get back into a higher orbit. That doesn't take anything away from either of those programs, but they ended up limiting us, making it harder to do the bigger things, if you will. Yes?
With the moon as a possible landing place, are there ways that humans can use it for solving problems like global warming and things of that nature?
I'm sorry, Jean, what's the question?
That with the moon as a possible landing place, say down the road, a few decades or something like that, is there the possibility, do you foresee, of us being able to use that resource as perhaps as a solution for things like global warming and other kinds of problems that we have here on Earth?
I hope so. Thank you. Where I come back to this always is as important as space exploration is, what makes it important is how it relates to the Earth and to us. I hope it helps. I believe it will.
Joe, perhaps some of these people have looked up in the sky and seen a colorful parachute-type contraption.
Contraption.
Soaring through the air. Would you maybe elaborate on who that is and what that might be?
I have the good fortune to have been able to expand my horizons into flight testing, into actually flying. And I found out over the years that one of the things I really enjoy is flying very small airplanes called ultralights. And I have a vehicle now, it's called a powered parachute. And when it's not too windy, which isn't very often here, but it does happen, I like to go up and I usually fly a couple thousand feet and take a look and make sure everybody's behaving themselves. if you see a parachute wandering around, that's probably, well, that will be me.
Joe, it's great. It's an honor to have you at Mack College.
Thank you.
A few years ago, we had an astronaut, on campus, and talked about the deterioration of the human physique in outer space, the size of the heart, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. Can you say more about that? That would be a monumental problem in going to Mars or wherever.
That I think that turns out to be the problem that our most concern is that when you put people in a weightless environment long term, the body does all sorts of things that are bad. We recently had one of the astronauts spend a year in space, and Scott, I've forgotten his name, but a twin, his brother stayed on ground and he spent a year in space so that they could compare these identical twins, what happened to one versus the other after a year. But that's a very serious concern. You know, when you set off to go someplace like Mars, when you finally get there, will you be able to get out of the spacecraft, right? So.
I could add one more shot. A few years ago, Yaman Asselt and I heard Edgar Mitchell, who was an astronaut,
mm-hmm.
who was outside the space capsule, umbilical cord, et cetera. And then he had this incredible, he spoke at KU, mystical experience mm-hmm. of the planet Earth at that time. Are you acquainted with him at all? Are you aware of that story?
I'm aware of the story. I'm not acquainted with him. But I have to imagine that would bring out everything inside of us to have an experience like that.
So, Joe, did you do a lot of the test flying yourself? Were you piloting a lot, doing some of the tests?
When I was working with the Air Force, no, I did ground.
Yeah.
never had the opportunity to fly in any of those jet aircraft.
Well, I've always been in awe of you, but that was going to make it like, oh, come on.
My airplanes fly a little slower.
Imagine.
In addition to my ultralight aircraft, I also have a regular airplane, and not surprisingly, I suppose, it's a 1939 It's the oldest airplane at the airport, and it is going through restoration right now.
Well, let's all join together, and I'm sorry, did I interrupt? So, thank you so much for being with us.